AD here, good day to you, good year even. It's actually day one of 2021 as I record this. Let's start as we mean to go on and get some Blender stuff out there. That brings us to today's video on the topic of lighting. This video actually is intended to be part of a much larger course on the topic. Quite a while back now, Gleb released two lighting courses, the realistic lighting course and the HDRI lighting course, which pretty much started the whole ball rolling here on Creative Shrimp for releasing courses. So since those courses were done quite a while ago and it's such an important subject, it makes sense to revisit it all for a brand new lighting course, of which, as usual, some of the chapters we can release here, like this video. So here I've got a spotlight which is just illuminating this subway scene, and it's just sat in front of the camera that we've got here. So I'm going to jump into the camera, reselect the spotlight that we've got there, and we can see it's set to spot. And there's loads of things that can be animated, as we can see by these little dots at the end of many of the properties that we've got here. Once pressing that little dot on the right, it turns into a larger diamond. And we can see down in the timeline that a keyframe has been placed on this lamp we have selected. But I'm going to undo that. We can also right click and insert keyframe. We can see there's the hotkey eye. If I right click here, I can insert a keyframe even for the type of light. So I can move to the next keyframe along with the right arrow. We're on frame 3 in this case now. And then I can switch this to the sun, super powerful sun. And then right click and insert the keyframe there, or just press the I key. And now using the left or right arrows on the keyboard, we can go between those two particular frames and see what it'd be like if the sun came down to ride the subway. Again, I can undo that, or just with those two keyframes selected, we can press X and delete them. So with some things not being as obvious to animate as other things, that segues quite nicely into how to even animate a light turning on. There's really two main ways. We have, of course, the property. We could, of course, animate the power. We're on frame 1 at the moment, so I'm going to set this to 0, which is essentially just the lamp is off. And then we can press I over there and insert the keyframe. I'm going to move forward to 1 frame and then take that back up to 800 as we had, and then another I. And then now 1 frame apart, it just switches straight on. Obviously, the benefit of this is that we can take this further away and now we have a nice gradient between it. But if we needed that just binary on off, we want to just snap it a frame apart. But I'm going to undo that though, get us back to where we were without those power keyframes. Another not so obvious way to animate the lamp coming on and off there is to animate this disable in viewports icon. And by the way, you may not see some of these icons by default, so just make sure they're enabled here in the filters. So if I disable that there and right click and insert a keyframe, right arrow on the keyboard to move forwards 1 frame, press the button again to enable it in the viewport, right click and insert keyframe. And now if we use the left and right arrows, we can see our light switching on and off. Note that there's not really a huge difference between the two methods there, animating here with the visibility or here with the power. It's probably just whether you want to be able to still see it in the interface or not. So if you do want to see it in the interface, then don't go with this visibility route, go with the power. There's actually great fun to be had with using this spot lamp as a sort of torch to create an ominous vibe. All we need to do is double tap R for a trackball style rotation and then just move around the mouse and hey presto. We can actually auto keyframe this as well to give it a very human natural movement, because it's going to record while we move it around in the viewport. So if we just enable this auto keyframing right here, then when we press play, double tap R while it's playing, you can see all those keyframes being laid down. And I'm just going to left click and press space to stop the animation playing there. And we can see we've laid down all of these keyframes. So here I've given the timeline a little bit more space. And really, as we can see, that's probably too many keyframes. So a quick tip is that we can actually switch this over from the timeline to, say, the graph editor, where we're going to get access to this key menu. And that will allow us to come to this section here. And we've got several options to optimize those keyframes there. I'm just going to go with clean keyframes. And then if we open this up, we've got a threshold and I can keep sliding this up and more keyframes should get removed. So eventually it should look a lot less dense with keyframes, but also keeps the essence of the animation. So here I've deleted all the keyframes and switched off the spot lamp that we were using for the torch. And instead, let's take a look at this strip lighting type light, which is this area light that we have here. What we can do with this is make it flicker. Now we could go through and keyframe in a load of different settings of the power property, but there's a way easier way to do that. And thankfully we're still in the graph editor here. And all we have to do is lay down a single keyframe. So I'm going to right click here and insert a keyframe. And now we have this power. Now what I can do is press the N key to open up the sidebar, and we have some modifiers. And this is where the magic happens. Great for a flickery light is the noise modifier. And at first that looks like nothing's actually happened, but if we press the home key, we can view it, and indeed we have noise. And by default, it doesn't really look like it's doing very much because we need to take our strength way higher. And here I've zoomed out so we can see the zero point. And really for light that's flickering on and off, we want this strength to be able to encompass that zero mark. In fact, probably our keyframe could do with being a little bit lower. And now we have some nightmarish flicker. Let's maybe slow it down a little bit, which we can do with the scale. So let's try that. That's looking like a pretty good effect. Now let's assume we actually want to only start it flickering a few frames in. So we can restrict our frame range and start it at around frame 6 or so. Actually, let's set our end point first, otherwise we're not going to see anything. But let's only start it after about 20 frames or so. So we get our initial keyframe position, which is currently set at 46. Then take a look at that in action. There are different blend types. We could use subtract, and that way we could raise our overall keyframe up a lot higher. But I'm perfectly happy in this instance to just use replace. Now I'm going to close the noise modifier there and take a look at this stepped interpolation modifier. Let's zoom in a little bit further. What this is basically doing is flattening out the value for a couple of frames in this case. So these sorts of lights can get stuck at a certain amount of power, and that's kind of what this is interpreting. So let's maybe turn that up a little bit and see what happens there. That's pretty good. And then add a final modifier in this case, the limits. So the height is the Y. So I'm going to place a minimum and maximum on Y. Let's set that up to say something like 250. And the minimum, let's come over to a point where it's completely black. So with these sorts of lights, you can sometimes get it where they don't completely go off. They have this ever so slight glow. So I'm going to set the minimum to be maybe to just where the bottom starts to be slightly illuminated, which is in this case is about 18. But let's say you have another flickery light and you want them both to have exactly the same information or value of power, I suppose we could put it. We could just copy all of these settings, but one of the best ways to do that would be to just make one lamp the driver of another. So for example, on this one, we can say right click and add driver. And now we get this helpful little driver menu. And basically we want this to be a scripted expression, and it's going to be a ridiculously simple expression because it's just var. Now what's var? That's whatever variable it is that we put down here. So we need to click this little icon and change that to the type of data we want, which is a single property. Then we need to indicate what type of property it is, which in our case, it's a lamp. Here from the pull down, we need to find the name of the other lamp settings. And if we actually go over to select it, we'll see what that's called, _striplighting.003. Actually, if we switch over to light.003, which we can see the name of just there rather than expanding out our outliner, you can see in this section here, it actually says light.004 in the lamp settings. This is the part that we want. So I'm going to come back to this one. We want to drive and then edit the driver by right clicking on there. Just pull this up here a little bit. And so in this bit here, we're going to want light.004. Now the final thing is to know what the path that we want here. Pretty simple, we just right click and copy the data path. Once we go back and edit our driver, we can just control V and we see that property is called energy, which might seem a little confusing, but the power field is basically behind the scenes as far as the code is concerned, it's calling it energy. And that's what we need to put into this data path field. Now if we press enter to confirm that, and then scrub through the frames, we should see that both of those lamps now have a power setting that is completely synchronized. So now we can take this striplighting.004, as we can see there, and we can right click and copy that driver and then start turning other lamps on and then just pasting that into there. And now we have three lamps all synchronized. But for this sort of thing, I actually like to use an empty to be the master. Basically a dummy object that we can create a unique custom property on that can control them all. So let's set that up. So our 3D cursor happens to be right here for the moment. So let's shift A to add in, let's do a cube. and the size. Let's take that right down just so that we can see it in the viewport and move it maybe off to the side like this. And I've just noticed we've laid down a keyframe, because if we check out our timeline, we can see we've still got our auto keyframing set. So I'm just going to delete that keyframe and then switch back over to our graph editor. And now let's come over to the object properties of the empty, scroll down a bit, and we've got our custom properties here at the bottom, and we can just add one, and then let's edit that. And the property name, let's change that to light. The property value can be one, the default value can be one. This isn't super important right now, as we're going to tweak all these in a moment. Let's say our maximum could be something like 1,000. Let's click OK. What's cool about these custom properties is that you don't need to dig around in here in the properties window. We can find them in our sidebar here, just in the properties section of the item there. You can see the item tab, and there's our light. So we can change this, and we can see it updating over here as well. Now I'm going to right click and place a keyframe on that custom property we've created. Once we've done that, we can see that pop up in the graph editor called light. What I'd like to do next is make this exactly the same as the lamp we've already used. So I'm just going to set the properties of this keyframe on the F curve to be the same as the lamp was. So it was placed at frame one. The value I'll copy from the lamp object, but without the W at the end there, the wattage. We just need the numerical info, otherwise we might get an error. Then I can select the empty in the viewport and then Control V to paste that in. Then I can select the lamp again and then find where our modifiers are and then click this little copy modifiers button. Again, go back over to our empty in the viewport and then click the little paste modifiers button, and then we've got all the animation detail we need. Now I can clear all that animation data that we had on the lamps. So first I'll find the main lamp that was driving them all, and then right click and clear those keyframes. Now I can select the other lamps and right click and delete those drivers. Nothing is being driven anymore, and so we need to set up our new driver that we can copy to all of the other lamps. So again, let's right click over the power field and choose add driver. Set the expression to var, and then our variable is going to be our custom property. So for that, we'll find our empty.001 object, which is the empty we created to hold our custom property. It's a single property, and then we can type in our path. Custom properties need to be written in a certain way within quotation marks and square brackets, but if unsure, we can just reselect our empty, find the property, and then right click and select copy data path. Then we just go back to edit the driver and just paste that in. With that done, I'm going to turn on all the other lamps we want to drive. Next, I'll select the last one in the outliner here and then shift select the first one to select them all there. And then I'm going to shift select the one we have the driver on. I'm going to select that one in the viewport, which should be the one pretty much closest to the camera there. Then we just need to go Control L to copy that animation data to all the other selected objects. Now, when we scrub through the timeline, we can be dazzled by the perfect synchronicity of such faulty lighting. Harmony among chaos. Actually, for full harmony, we need to have these meshes here that hover slightly above the lamps themselves. Those emission materials that we can see faintly glowing at the moment. We need to have those synchronized as well. So let's set that up. So all the meshes for that can be found here, and they all share this same lamp emission _1. Let's just take a look at that material a little bit. It's very simple, just an emission shader and a multiply node, just giving that a tiny little bit of color. And then this second socket, we're just plugging into a value node, which we can use as a kind of strength, separate from the overall strength. So let's give this value, this strength, a driver, which is really simple, because to synchronize it, we can simply copy the driver that we have here on one of the lights and then just paste it onto that value. Now things are looking a little bit on the bright side. I'm just going to turn that down to say 1, but let's just explore how we could do this with a couple of math nodes as well. We could sort of fine tune things here in this strength, but this is a little bit too bright for me. But first I'm going to set the lowest level. So I'm going to find somewhere where it's completely off, which looks like about there. And then let's set how dim we want these lamps to be under that setting. So really this is at 18, which is our lowest limit that we set in the modifier. Let's just confirm that by trying to select that empty, come back over to our limits, and we can see we've set the minimum to 18. Let's come back over to the mesh, so we can get access to this material. In fact, let's just pin this for the moment, just in case we do click away again. That way we'll always see these nodes here. So to set a new kind of limit, a lower limit for this mesh, the material, we can just unmute this math node, this subtract node, and I'm just going to increase this value until it looks low enough. And I'm happy with it around 17.5 or so. Let's take a look at it. The bright side, maybe that's slightly over bright. Also, it's worth noting that in the render properties tab, I've got bloom enabled here with just some standard default settings, but that's a little bit too bright. So I think first I'm going to duplicate this math node and change that to a multiplied, or we could use a divide really, but I'm going to set this value to below 1 so that it can start to reduce the overall power there. So let's just set that to something that looks pretty good, which is about there, maybe 0.2, something like that. After we scrub through to find a frame at its very lowest, which is right here on frame 81, we might find that we've destroyed that lower value. So I'm going to turn the amount that we're subtracting down. So there's just a faint glow, something like 3.5. And then if we scrub through to find some very, very bright areas, we can see the extreme of that. And I think that looks pretty good. Now, the thing is, we don't actually need to rely on these nodes here in the graph. We can actually place them into the driver itself. So I'm going to do that by just selecting them both, pressing M to mute them. And then I'm going to right click on the driver and click to edit it. And then I'm just going to write the same thing basically in here. So we times it by 0.2 and then we subtracted that by 3.5. And then that should basically do the same thing. If in doubt of your orders of operations there, we could just keep things in brackets just to make sure that this happens first and then we subtract 3.5, but it shouldn't make any difference in this case. And then when we scrub through, we should find that everything works as it was, even when it was just the nodes. So that's going to conclude this video, which is technically part 5 of 6 in this particular section of the course. But who knows where it'll really fall after all the bits and pieces are actually all put together. These things always get bigger than we initially planned for. If you've been following Gleb or I on the socials, you may have seen the occasional lighting image as we've been working our way through the course. And if you have any further ideas or suggestions that you think that we should throw in there as well, we should include it, then please give us a shout. Until then, we'll see you next time.